In this video, we will discuss on ECG changes in various valvular heart diseases. In order to understand the ECG changes, the pathophysiology of each valvular heart disease will also be explained. Let's start with mitral stenosis. In mitral stenosis, there is narrowing of the mitral valve orifice. This causes decreased blood flow into the left ventricle. So the left ventricle is underfilled. Since the blood has to pass through the narrow orifice from left atrium to the left ventricle, the left atrial pressure increases. The increased left atrial pressure causes the enlargement of left atrium. There are also back pressure changes in the pulmonary vasculature, causing pulmonary hypertension. Due to pulmonary hypertension, there is right ventricular hypertrophy and tricuspid regurgitation. The enlarged left atrium causes P mitral in ECG, that is broad and bifid P wave in lead 2. One small box in ECG is 40 milliseconds in duration. Broad P wave means P wave duration more than 110 milliseconds. And bifid P wave means duration between two peaks is more than 40 milliseconds. In V1, it is seen as biphasic P wave with negative terminal portion more than 40 milliseconds in duration and more than 1 millimeter deep. Pulmonary hypertension and right ventricular hypertrophy causes right axis deviation and tall R wave in V1. That is more than 7 millimeter tall. If left atrium further increases in size, atrial fibrillation occurs. There is varying RR interval and loss of P waves. In other words, the P mitral disappears. ECG changes in mitral regurgitation is similar to mitral stenosis. In mitral regurgitation, the leaflets of mitral leaflet don't coapt well, leading to leakage of blood into the left atrium during ventricular systole. Thus, there is volume overload to the left atrium. This causes left atrium to enlarge. The increased volume of blood in left atrium reaches the left ventricle. It causes left ventricular volume overload, leading to eccentric left ventricular hypertrophy. And with time, left ventricle dilates. As the disease progresses, there is increase in left ventricular end-diastolic pressure and left ventricle failure occurs. This leads to back pressure changes in pulmonary vasculature, causing pulmonary venous congestion, pulmonary hypertension, right ventricular hypertrophy, and tricuspid regurgitation. The enlarged left atrium is seen as P mitral in lead 2, an enlargement of terminal negative portion of P wave in V1, as seen in mitral stenosis. Pulmonary hypertension and right ventricular hypertrophy causes right axis deviation and tall R wave in V1, that is more than 7 mm tall, as seen in mitral stenosis. If left atrium further increases in size, atrial fibrillation sets in, as in mitral stenosis. Left ventricular dilatation and hypertrophy are observed as increased R-wave voltage, that is more than 26 mm in V4, V5, V6, and ST segment depression and T-wave inversion in V4, V5, and V6. It should be noted that in mitral stenosis, the left ventricle is underfilled and left ventricle function is preserved, whereas in mitral regurgitation, left ventricle function deteriorates with time. ECG changes in aortic stenosis. In aortic stenosis, there is narrowing of aortic valve orifice. This increases the left ventricular systolic pressure. That is, there is left ventricular pressure overload. Concentric left ventricular hypertrophy occurs as a compensatory mechanism. Left ventricular hypertrophy is seen in ECG as increased R wave voltage, that is more than 26 mm in V4, V5, and V6, and ST segment depression and T wave inversion in V4, V5, and V6. Left ventricular hypertrophy can also be diagnosed by Sokolow-Lyon criteria, that is R in V5 or V6 plus S wave in V1 should be more than 35 mm. Additional ECG changes in left ventricular hypertrophy is left axis deviation. In severe calcific aortic stenosis, extension of calcium into the conduction system can cause heart block and left bundle branch block. Left bundle branch block is seen in ECG as QRS duration more than 120 milliseconds. In V1, there is dominant S wave, that is RS complex, that is small R wave and deep S wave, or QS complex with no preceding R wave. In V6, there is broad notched M-shaped R wave. As time progresses, LV end diastolic pressure rises, which causes back pressure changes, causing left atrium to enlarge, which is seen as P mitral in L2 or enlargement of terminal negative portion of P wave in V1. ECG changes in aortic regurgitation. In aortic regurgitation, there is leakage of blood from aorta to left ventricle during diastole. So there is left ventricular volume overload. This leads to LV eccentric hypertrophy and dilatation. In ECG, it is seen as increased R wave voltage, that is more than 26 mm, and ST segment depression and T wave inversion in the leads V4, V5, and V6. Left axis deviation is also present. Left volume overload pattern is also seen, that is, prominent Q waves in lead 1 AVL, V3 to V6, and relatively small R waves in V1. As time progresses, LV end diastolic pressure rises, which causes back pressure changes, causing left atrium to enlarge, which is seen as P mitral in L2 and enlargement of terminal negative portion of P wave in V1. ECG in tricuspid stenosis. In tricuspid stenosis, there is right atrial hypertrophy. In ECG, it is seen as peaked P wave called P pulmonale. P pulmonale is defined as P wave more than 2.5 mm in height in inferior leads 2, 3 and AVF, or more than 1.5 mm in height in lead V1 and V2. In 50% of patients, atrial fibrillation develops and P pulmonale disappears. ECG in tricuspid regurgitation. Tricuspid regurgitation is usually due to left heart lesions causing pulmonary hypertension, as discussed earlier. So in these patients, the ECG changes are due to right ventricular hypertrophy causing right axis deviation and tall R wave in V1, that is more than 7 mm tall. Tricuspid regurgitation as such can cause incomplete right bundle branch block, Q waves in V1 and atrial fibrillation. Let's complete the video here. Hope it was useful. See you soon in the next video.